Belinda and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of Sunrise Over Mercy Court, written by Fiona McCallum and read by Jennifer Vuletic. Dedication for CW. Part 1. Chapter 1. Elsie was in the pantry tidying up the jars and tins and checking that all was neat and in order and everything was correctly labelled. A lack of labelling wasn't a problem for them, well, so far, with both of them knowing, for instance, that the icing sugar and not the corn flour occupied the bulbous-shaped old coffee jar, and the corn flour the taller, squarer and more slender glass jar, despite their contents appearing identical through the clear glass. But they didn't want to cause more of a kerfuffle for daughters Janine and Corinne after their demise, on their own terms if all went to plan, than was inevitable. Thus, they were in an organising and sorting frenzy, performing whatever was the opposite of nesting. Purging, Elsie thought it might be termed. That probably wasn't quite right either, was it? She frowned before letting it go. Anyway, this was one of the items on her and Howard's to-do list that they were gradually making their way through. They both loved being orderly and getting things done and out of the way. And there wasn't a whole lot else to do at their age of 78 in between the medical appointments, just general maintenance, they had no health issues, and attending the funerals of their peers, which was happening far too regularly. Elsie was enjoying being deep in the pantry. It meant less of the disconcerting occurrences where she thought the movements out of the corner of her eye grabbing her attention were their dear old dog Maisie, who had succumbed to age a month ago. Maisie had never been into the pantry. The space was a bit too tight for a human and a large German shepherd, and the dog had remained cautious to the end. Elsie still felt guilty for not being there with her and Howard at the final moment, and also at the thought that she was glad she hadn't been. The best thing about Maisie's passing, though God, she missed her more than she could probably put into words, was that they hadn't had to make the decision to have her put to sleep after all. They'd spent ages fretting over it, questioning each other over and over about how they'd know when the time was right. The dear old dog had kept them on their toes and on tenterhooks for the last few months of her life. One day she'd seem to be reasonably energetic and bright. The next she'd be spread out on the floor looking like her demise was imminent. They'd had a great vet, a kind, gentle, patient and reassuring woman. But she wasn't living with the dog and didn't do house calls. Lucky that, Elsie had often thought, otherwise they probably would have spent a sizeable chunk of their remaining superannuation having her popping in to check on the dog. As it was, several times they had rushed poor Maisie in to see her. Thankfully, the dear old dog didn't mind the vet surgery and loved being in the car, only to have the dog brighten up completely and be sent home again after a quick checkover. That roller coaster had been hard and a strain on their nerves. But the last time Howard had been at home alone with her, Elsie having finally, after all the COVID palaver, felt safe enough from the dreadful disease to meet a friend, Judith, for coffee and to go to a movie. She'd had her phone switched off and had forgotten to turn it back on once she was on the bus heading for home. She was so out of practice with catching the bus, it was her first time in around 3 years, that she'd been caught up in remembering to tap her card and put it away again, and checking her phone had completely slipped her mind. She'd never been as keen on the thing as Howard. Useful, yes, but also a bit hard on the eyes, she found. She'd entered the house humming to herself and wandered down the hall only to come out into the open-plan kitchen, dining and living area to find Howard at the kitchen table, head in hands, sobbing. Slowly he'd revealed that soon after Elsie had left, Maisie had collapsed on the floor, actually flopped from standing this time, and he'd not been able to find a pulse. He'd rushed her to the vet, only a few minutes away by car, and urged them to revive her so Elsie could have the chance to say goodbye. As Elsie stood there with her arms around Howard, head on his shoulder, sobbing herself now, the pain, relief, guilt had started. The relief at not being there and having to help make any decisions, and the guilt of not being there to support Howard and also not holding Maisie's paw, never leaving her. Being there for her right to the end, like she'd promised her so many times. How he'd even had the strength to lift the large dog into the car and then into the vet from the car park and hadn't done his back in was beyond both of their comprehension. Her grief had begun in a split second, as grief always did. She'd walked into the house, keen to discuss the movie, cheerful, buoyant, feeling finally fear-free about being out in public properly after the COVID years, and look what she'd come home to. In an instant, there was a big hole in their lives and souls, and the maelstrom of emotions attached to it all. In the first minutes, all she could do was apologise over and over for her inattention regarding the phone. Howard, of course, her darling Howard, best friend of 74 years, husband of 59, was his usual beautiful self. Sad, of course, but not at all upset with Elsie. He was more concerned about her not having the chance to say goodbye. That was the reason for the 8 missed calls on her phone, he'd explained later. They'd revived dear old Maisie and he'd wanted her to say goodbye. When she'd died soon after, they gently said this was it. She'd gone. Gradually, he'd pulled himself together enough to ask for her to be cremated and to let him know when to collect her ashes, paid, and driven home. Elsie ranged from being bereft and sick with guilt to glad and relieved that her last goodbye had been that morning as Maisie had followed her to the front door. She'd said, "I'll see you later, darling girl. Remember, you are loved," as she had every time she'd left the house. They had both told the dog they loved her many times throughout the day, because the precious thing had arrived from the RSPCA after an apparently horrendous former life, which had left her timid and malnourished, and they'd taken it upon themselves to reassure her as often as they could. Elsie sighed, let her reminiscing slide into the background, and returned to her task in the pantry. She blinked and stared at the 2 tins of chickpeas she'd just found buried right at the back of the cupboard. When had they bought these? Though why was the more pertinent question. She racked her brain for a recipe they might have needed them for once, a salad perhaps, but came up empty. They hadn't entertained in ages. Their first time having people other than their daughters around since the pandemic was next Thursday. She left the tiny room, carrying the tins, frowning, and crossed the space to where Howard was in the study working through the many photos. His current task, also on their to-do list, was to sort the digital photos and scan all those in the many albums and save them so Corinne and Janine would have a copy each of everything in digital form. They could fight over the physical albums at a later date. "Howard?" she called from the doorway, holding up the cans of chickpeas. He said, his eyes still on the screen in front of him. "Damn stock market, when are you going to start going up again?" he thought with a sigh and shook his head. He'd checked it while taking a break from sorting the photos and wished he hadn't. "Any idea why we have 2 tins of chickpeas in the pantry?" Howard backed his chair back and turned fully around to face Elsie.
Let me just think for a moment."
He took his glasses off and rubbed his face.
"Oh, I know. I remember now," he said a few moments later. "We got those that last big shop we did just as the supermarket went completely mad with the people hoarding toilet paper and everything. They were the last thing on the shelves, so I grabbed them."
He shuddered in response to the flood of memories. How traumatic those last days in the supermarket just before lockdowns had been. All that jostling and fear and panic. He'd got caught up in it and was a little embarrassed to admit he'd been influenced, hence the damned chickpeas which he knew nothing about, other than the fact they apparently came in tins.
"What? Because they were lonely," Elsie said.
He grinned at his darling wife and rolled his eyes. "Trust you, cheeky minx." How wonderful and incredible, really, to still have a wife you adored, loved, and regularly found hilarious after nearly 6 decades.
"Very funny. No, because I thought they'd be useful, you know, if the worst happened. Nutritionally, I think, was where my mind was going. Remember back then, the chaos? We didn't know what would happen with the supply chain or if we'd be able to buy food in lockdown, etc. Remember?
Oh, God, yes, that's right. Elsie shuddered as the memories flooded back. It was quite incredible how quickly she seemed to forget the details of major parts in her life. She shuddered again.
Okay, so what are we going to do with them? She said. Eat them, I suppose, Howard said. We're not throwing them out, if that's what you're suggesting.
He frowned. Do we even like chickpeas? I sure hope so.
No. Now, come on, Howard, when would I ever advocate for wasting food?
Sorry. No, of course. I'm being a bit tetchy. I'm trying to sort through a stack of images that are almost identical within hundreds. Damn this digital photography that's made it so easy to end up with thousands of photos with the mere press of a button. Oh, well.
He sighed and gave his face another rub. Elsie stood there with the cans and waggled them. She really wanted to deal with them, despite being aware she was being slightly obsessive about them, though they both were, about all sorts of things. It seemed to have come with retirement 15 years ago, and more recently had stepped up a notch in their determined effort to get their affairs in order and move on to the last item on their list.
Let me see,
Howard said, wheeling himself back to the desk. Now facing the computer screen, he tapped on the keyboard.
We could make hummus. We like that, don't we?
Yes. Oh, yum.
Okay, here's a recipe with plenty of 5-star reviews. We'll also need tahini. What's that when it's at home?
Sesame seed paste, isn't it?
Elsie said.
Ah, yes, you're quite right. Well, why did they just say that then? They're fine with peanut paste. Don't need to give that a fancy name.
Why does everything have to be so damned complicated?
Who's they, dear?
Elsie said, just for fun. She loved when he muttered about the strangeness of the world. They enjoyed great long conversations about how screwed up everything was, another major reason for this final plan of theirs. But Howard ignored her, simply waved his hand and kept on peering at the screen and tapping on the keyboard.
And how the hell did I get to this age without knowing that?
He muttered, shaking his head.
Right,
he continued a moment later, making a note on the back of an old envelope on the top of the stack beside him.
Tahini. Garlic, salt, olive oil and lemon juice we have plenty of. Might get some fresh ones. Cumin. Do we have any cumin, dear? It's a spice by the looks.
Yes, that's in the cupboard. I saw it yesterday when I inventoried the spices. You know, it's the one we use in stews and curries.
Great. Well, I'll just print this recipe out and we're good to go.
He carefully tore off the portion of the envelope containing his list and, after a final tap on the keyboard, turned to the printer as it roared to life. He tucked the scrap of paper into his pocket, collected the page from the printer and got up.
I'll see you in a bit,
he said as he handed Elsie the recipe on his way past.
You can bone up on this, if you like, while I'm gone.
Are you going now?
I thought I might. Good to have a mission. I need to clear my head for a bit. This is doing me in, he added.
Elsie sympathised. He'd been doing this for months, on and off, right through last year. Before that, it was research on the family tree. He'd loved that. But this task was dragging on, and he often complained that it was driving him spare. Why did old people use that term? What did it even mean, she wondered, before letting it go. She blinked it away just before Howard kissed her on the forehead.
Anything else?
He said, moving past her.
No, I don't think so.
It didn't matter anyway, Elsie thought. Howard trekked to the supermarket at least once a day, sometimes twice. She knew it was partly because of how much he missed Maisie, their gentle walks together and also her presence. She'd noticed his patience with the photos had shortened considerably since he'd lost his companion, whom he used to mutter to almost constantly as she snoozed in her bed or sprawled out on the floor. She too understood the impact of this large missing piece from their lives and the accompanying constant haze of grief, so she didn't rib him about how often he traipsed back and forth to the shops. It was very convenient for her too, As part of their planning, it also made sense to keep less fresh fruit, veg and meat on hand than previously. Also because Howard preferred to walk to the shop and there was only so much he could carry. At their age, they had to pace themselves in all areas. It was a vicious cycle, really. Not much food in the house because he didn't want to carry much food from the supermarket. Or rather, a friendly cycle, she decided, because it kept her darling husband occupied.
Okay, back soon. Call if you remember anything, he said, holding up his phone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.